Hello everyone, this is the Women in Science series, and today I am truly honored to talk with Professor Karen Uhlenbeck, an outstanding American mathematician, one of the founders of modern geometric analysis. In 2019, Professor Uhlenbeck won the Abel Prize for her pioneering achievements in geometric partial differential equations, gauge theory and integrable systems, and for the fundamental impact of her work on analysis, geometry, and mathematical physics. She's the first and so far the only woman to win the prize since its inception in 2003. Hey, good morning, Professor. Thank you very, very much for accepting my invitation.
Good morning to you, and I'm pleased to be here. Thank you.
First of all, I would like to ask you about differential equations. You are known, among the others, for your work on partial differential equations. And I wonder if you could please explain to us in layman's terms, what are differential equations? What do they analyze? And what are they used for?
Well, like most of mathematics, differential equations arose from scientific observations and to describe natural phenomena like motion of water or the motion of the stars and something like that. And on the other hand, the power of them is that the equations and the types of equations and the modeling that we do that we get from one subject, like say astronomy, transfers to abstract mathematics, which can be applied to any field, like economics or biology or something like that. That's the power of mathematics. Now, differential equations are a little hard to understand because most people don't deal with it. The only equations most people know how to deal with are arithmetic equations, where you say, I take 4 plus 3 is 7, 4 times 3 is 12. And these are specific examples of equations where there are not any variables involved. But on the other hand, most people know how to use equations with variables. For example, if you transfer from Fahrenheit degrees to centigrade degrees, you take the Fahrenheit degrees, you subtract 32, and you multiply by 5/8. And that's an equation with an unknown, giving another unknown, that is the equation, the function, it's a function actually that transforms degrees Fahrenheit to degrees centigrade. And so there's an unknown in the equation. Now, differential equations are equations of that sort, but the unknowns are functions. Now, so the first thing you have to know is what is a function? And this is, in fact, people do know what functions are because you've looked at graphs all the time. But a function is simply giving the one variable in terms of another, and this function is regarded as kind of an unknown. And a typical example would be like if you're trying to model, say, some weather in an area of the Earth, and you might have three actual variables that you know, namely, at every point you know the height, you know you have the three variables, which is the spatial variables on which you're describing it. Then you might have the height of the land on the XY variable. You might have the speed of the wind, and you might have the temperature. And the unknown that you're looking for is, say, you want to find three variables, that is you want to find the variables of the temperature and the wind speed in terms at a later time in terms of an earlier time. So you actually write down, this is how you model weather, is you write down an equation that actually predicts from the beginning temperature and wind speed, a later temperature at wind speed. And those equations are all differential equations. I mean, differential equations, they write equations down for functions of things rather than unknowns themselves. So the functions become the unknowns. And I think when people are trying to learn higher math, probably the hardest step is to get transfer to what a function is. Because once you understand what a function is, then actually the slope of the function is the derivative. And so you actually take the slope of the function and you put it in the function or the many functions you have and you write down an equation. As I said, most differential equations originate in the beginning from physical objects. I mean, in fact, right at the beginning of calculus, Newton, of course, was looking at the equations of gravity, and first thing he did was write down some differential equations to describe it. And it's very much differential equations are a basic fundamental part of all scientific modeling. That's not actually exactly true for the very modern stuff in deep learning for computers, but they still have functions. I mean, so the concept of a function is probably the hardest thing. And these are equations that give you information about functions, so.
Much of your breakthrough research has a lot to do with soap bubbles. So I would like to ask you why are you interested in soap bubbles?
Soap bubbles are descriptive, okay? Let me describe to you what the phenomena is. So you have this complicated equation, okay? And it actually doesn't matter what it is, but it turns out there's a certain very special kind of equations which are called scale invariant. So that means is if you have a situation in which you've written down an equation, and if you multiply the variables in the space that you're describing by a constant, you don't change the problem. So in other words, it's kind of like if you haven't done some geometry or something, it's hard to imagine, but you're describing something that happens on a plane in front of you, and you get the same description whether if you make a very small circle or whether you get make a very large circle, you have the same description. So it turns out that there are these differential equations that you don't understand what's going on. But if you look at a very small region around the place where you think the bubble is happening, and you blow it up to a big ball, a big disk, then you can actually see what's happening and get a description of what's happening. So it's kind of like something exciting is happening over a point. And I called it a bubble. I mean, I didn't know how else to describe all the interesting stuff is happening right at this point. And if you just blow it up to a bigger region, then you can see what's happening. And so it's not actually descriptive of soap bubbles. It's actually trying to describe sort of like a lot of stuff happening at a point. And if you actually blow that up, you can actually see what's happening at that point, not in a region. So this is, I don't know, it's to do with this invariance under scale, anyway.
Yeah, I know it's not easy to talk about mathematics at the level that you deal with it in layman's terms, but I would like to ask you this, because almost every day I meet people who say, oh, I hated mathematics at school. I was terrified of mathematics. Mathematics is so difficult. And I would like to ask you, what do you say when somebody what do you answer when somebody asks, where is the beauty in mathematics? How did you come to love it?
But I mean, I have people hate mathematics because the teacher told them something and they said why. And the
Professor, now I don't hear you. Could you please
try I have my hand on the microphone. Okay. Usually, my theory is that people were told to do something and the student said why, and the teacher says, I'm not going to tell you, just do it. I mean, to me, mathematics has always been like a puzzle. It's like a puzzle. If you try to do things in mathematics, patterns arise. And if you actually catch on to mathematics, then you really notice that there are patterns to what's happening. But asking the question why and being told that just learn it, it turns anybody off. To me, mathematics is like a puzzle. I mean, I have recently got addicted to the game Spelling Bee in the New York Times, and they give you 7 letters, and they want you to make all the letters, the words that you can out of those 7 letters. And so you start looking for patterns, you start forming patterns, you start learning what you learned from yesterday about words that you didn't know then and you learn now. And it makes patterns and you come up with this beautiful list of words. Now, mathematics is actually better than Spelling Bee because you get to make your own words. So the first thing that happens to me when I do Spelling Bee is, what happens if I change the rules? Or sometimes they have classes. So anyway, mathematics is very much like a puzzle. But the great thing about doing mathematics and being a mathematician is you get to make the puzzle and to change the puzzle, and you get to talk to other people about doing it. So for people who do mathematics, it's better than the best puzzles that you can come up with.
When you studied mathematics and then you did your PhD research, you were one of very few women, it's easy to guess, in this field. And did you come across any stereotypes, any barriers, prejudices?
Well, I mean, look, when I was a high school student in the 1950s, you remember how old I am, women weren't allowed to do anything interesting. I mean, you could be an airline hostess, you could be, that was a new exciting job. You could be a librarian, you could be a teacher, you could be a nurse. And actually there were no girls' sports, so you couldn't play sports in school. I mean, you could be in the band, so I was in the band. But, you know, women musicians were, you know, the symphonies were all women and so forth. So when I was growing up, women weren't allowed to do anything. So, I mean, the question of meeting problems, I mean, I don't know. Frankly, I don't think mathematics was particularly bad that way. I think women weren't supposed to do anything. And I also went to the University of Michigan, and the state universities were better. They admitted women from the very beginning, and somehow or other, these farmers or whoever they were out in the plains of Michigan and so forth wanted their daughters to be educated. And so, I had other women in my math classes. It's true that I only had one professor the whole time I was in college and graduate school. I had only one, I mean, in anything, I had only one woman professor, but there were no expectations. That is, nobody expected you to do anything either. And of course, mathematicians are very generous in one sense. And that is, when they meet good students, they encourage them. And I think, you know, maybe they're very surprised they meet a good student that's a woman or that's from Vietnam or that's black. But I mean, when they meet a good student, they actually encourage them. And the question is, and I wanted to learn. I had discovered learning was a great, a wonderful thing to do. And I didn't think too much about the future.
Could you tell us a little more about Karen Edge, the Karen Edge Fellowship Program?
Oh, yes. Well, I mean, when I when I went through college and university and postdoc and so forth, the most difficult period of my time was when I actually had a job and I was suddenly supposed to be somebody in a field where there were very few women. And I found that a very difficult period of time. And luckily at that time, there wasn't a lot of pressure to mentor other women yet, but there weren't a lot of women to contact. And I also just didn't know how to behave. And so when I thought about the difficulties that are clearly true for minority students and mathematicians, it seemed to me that that period of time, which was most difficult for me, would be most difficult for them. When they had an assistant professorship, they were suddenly in a period of responsibility, and nowadays they're of course expected to mentor other minority students and junior people. And so I felt that, I didn't need the money, and so I felt that was the appropriate place to donate my my money. Mm-hmm.
Today you are a role model for many young people, probably especially women aspiring to become mathematicians. But did you have a role model? Was there anyone who inspired you when you were a young girl?
Well, you know, I thought about that. You know, I had to give a speech. And at some point it occurred to me that this was something to talk about, and I immediately remembered admiring Julia Child so much when I was in graduate school. I mean, it was everybody watched Julia Child. She was actually quite, she's this immense 6 foot tall woman with this bubbling sense of humor, and yes. Did a cooking show, and she just carried everything off with aplomb, and she was obviously so loved cooking, and she had some disasters. Like there was one, I still remember the time that she dropped the turkey on the floor, and television was a little different back then, and then she said, oh, luckily I have another one in the kitchen, and went and got it. So but also I realized that what the person that really helped me the most when I was starting out my career was Virginia Woolf. Virginia Woolf was a very well-known novelist who struggled a lot, a tremendous amount with, of course, problems due to her gender, and had difficulty. It was the same in the 50s as it was back in the 20s when she was growing up. Women just weren't expected to do anything. That was, but she had, wrote diaries, and also she had many things to overcome. I mean, in particular, I still remember that when she got page proofs for her books, she would actually, basically send her into depression. So I always thought of Virginia Woolf whenever I had to look at page proofs, which I hated to do. And I didn't have the sense to ask for help either. So I can't say that I had role models, at least. My mother is an artist, and my mother comes from a family of strong women. So I suppose I got some things from them, from her. Anyway.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much once again for joining me for this opportunity to meet you and talk with you.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure.